Hi, I'm Steve Cook, here with my friend Todd Hyde at the USS Midway Museum. Todd was a navigator on a U.S. Navy destroyer and taught for several years at the New York Maritime Academy. Before I retired, I was an oceanographer, and as such, I had to use navigational tools to plan and conduct scientific operations at sea. Together, we're going to show you how to read a nautical chart. To get started, follow us below. Welcome to one of our Midway University classrooms aboard the museum, the perfect place to learn about nautical charts. Nautical charts are used by mariners to find the best water routes between their current location and their destination. A nautical chart is similar in many ways to a road map. Here's a map of the city of San Diego, which gives us important information about land, such as streets, highways, and parks. A nautical chart gives important information to mariners about water depth, best courses to steer when on the water. This is a nautical chart of the San Diego Bay. Just like on road maps, nautical charts use colors to depict information. Much of what you see on a nautical chart represents water areas. What colors do you see are used to depict water? That's right, light blue and white. What color depicts land? Light brown. Marshlands? Green. And restricted areas where boaters are not allowed are colored magenta or purple. We can easily make out the areas of the bay and the land. There's Point Loma, North Island, and the city of San Diego. And right here is Navy Pier, where the USS Midway is berthed. You'll see that the bottom of the chart ends just south of National City, so it doesn't show the southern end of the bay. The chart maker cut off the southern end of the bay and placed it in the upper right-hand corner of the chart because that area was all land. And this is a chart about the water. Now we can find our way around South Bay, which include places like the Coronado Cays, Chula Vista Harbor. Let's look at the upper left-hand corner of the chart. This is where the title of the chart is located. It tells us that the chart covers San Diego Bay in California on the west coast of the United States. This information is located in the least important part of the chart, in this case, over the light brown area that depicts land. Also located in this area is the scale of the chart. In this case, it is 1 to 12,000. This means that one unit of measurement on the chart is equal to 12,000 units on the actual bay. Let's apply the chart scale using a ruler to measure the length of the Navy Pier, where the Midway Museum is located. We can see that the pier is exactly 1 inch long. 1 inch on the chart equals 12,000 inches on the bay. 12,000 inches divided by 12 inches in a foot equals 1,000 feet. How many yards is that? 1,000 feet divided by 3 feet in a yard equals 333.3 yards. That's the length of the Navy Pier, more than the length of 3 football fields. You can use a ruler to measure distances between 2 points anywhere in the chart and tell how far apart they are on the bay. Knowing the scale used on a chart helps a navigator estimate the distances between any 2 locations. Also located in this area is important information about how the depth of the water is measured, either in feet, meters, or fathoms. By the way, there are 6 feet in a fathom. Look here. How is the water depth measured on this chart? That's right, in feet at low tide. That's when the water should be shallowest. Other information in this area that is important to navigators are the date the chart was drawn, tidal information, and how the heights of landforms and structures are measured. Look, right here in the middle of the brown land area is a large circle with compass points marked on it. This is called a compass rose because it looks something like a rose with petals around its edges. Let's take a closer look at it. First, you may notice that it isn't just one circle, but 2, one inside the other. Let's look at the outside circle first. Notice that there is a star near the top of the circle. This star points to true geographical north. Maybe they used the star here to represent the North Star that early navigators used to steer their ships across the seas at night. This star lets the reader know the top of the chart is north. the bottom south, and so on. This outer ring is used to let the reader know the cardinal points of the compass. North is at 0 degrees. Moving to the right around the circle, east is at 90 degrees, south is at 180 degrees, west is at 270 degrees, and moving back to the top of the circle, we find that north is also at 360 degrees. Those are the four cardinal points of a compass. Now let's look at the inner circle. Notice that instead of a star, there is an arrow pointing north, but it is offset to the right of the star on the outer circle. This indicates magnetic north, or the direction the compass on your boat or ship will point. How many degrees to the right of the star on the outer circle is the arrow on the inner circle pointing? It's about 14 degrees to the right. That 14 degree difference between magnetic north and true north is known as local variation. This variation will change from place to place around the world. So navigators using magnetic compasses aboard their ships or boats will need to know the variation in the area they are sailing so they can steer the correct course instead of sailing to the right or to the left. If a navigator does not adjust their course according to the magnetic variation, he or she could miss their destination by hundreds of miles on the open sea. Now let's look at some other symbols used on the chart. What do you think these green circles are for? These are designated anchorages where ships waiting to come into the harbor can anchor until there is space available at one of the piers. Can you find any of these circles inside the bay? That's right, there are five of them. Sometimes, when I'm on the Midway Museum, I see ships anchored at these anchorages in the bay. Now let's look at the land around the bay. Remember, that's the light brown areas on the chart. Remember where Point Loma is located on the chart? It's on the western side of San Diego Bay. Notice the black lines. They are called contour lines, and they connect points of equal elevation above the mean low water line of the bay. If you stood here, you would be 100 feet above the water line. Here, you would be 200 feet above the waterline. What's the highest point you could go? That's right, 400 feet. Contour lines are depicted under the water as well. Navigators need to know the depth of the water so they don't run their ships or boats aground as they navigate around the bay. Look closely at the water depth off the Silver Strand. You can see 6, 12, and 18-foot contour lines off the shoreline. If you look around the chart, you will see that these contour lines are used extensively to mark the locations of equal water depths. Black lines are also used to indicate other things on the chart, such as buildings and boat docks, things a mariner might be able to see from the water. So a nautical chart is a lot like a land map, but with critical, detailed information for mariners. I think you have a good idea of the layout of a nautical chart thus far. Todd is going to show you some of the symbols used to help a navigator pilot his or her ship or boat safely around the harbor. These symbols are called aids to navigation. Thanks for watching.
Hi, my name is Todd High. Now that Steve has shown you some of the general characteristics of a nautical chart, I'm going to help you learn how to read the symbols or the aids to navigation that mariners use to make their way safely around a harbor. First, let's look at all those small numbers printed in black on the blue and white areas of the chart. Each number is the sounding or depth of water measured at the mean low tide. This means that the number is the shallowest the water will be at the point marked on the chart. Do you remember what the depths are measured in? That's right. The chart states the depths are measured in feet. Now, let's look at the entrance to the bay between Point Loma and North Island. Is the water depth greater in the blue areas or in the white areas? Correct again. The blue areas are depths of 0 to 18 feet, and the white is 19 feet and deeper. That's a great clue to remember when you are looking at a nautical chart. White areas on the chart mean deeper water, and light blue indicates shallow water. Now look closely at the green circles, the anchorages Steve talked about off the Silver Strand. See those letters S and SH? S stands for sand, and SH for shells. Those letters tell the navigator what the bottom is made of so they can determine how best to anchor their ships. In order for navigators to move safely into and out of a harbor or bay, they need to be able to read and interpret other important symbols on the chart. These symbols are known as aids to navigation and include such things as buoys, lights, and range markers. All of these symbols are used to mark the edges of dredged channels, as well as dangers such as rocks and wrecks. The main device used to mark channels or a safe passage through shallow waters is the buoy. A buoy is a floating device that is anchored to the bottom of the bay or harbor. It may have a light the same color as the buoy, so navigators can see it at night. In San Diego Bay, lighted green and red buoys mark the edges of the main dredge channel. Green buoys are always used to mark the left side of a channel. Red buoys are always used to mark the right side. Mariners use a saying to remember the channel buoy colors. It is red, right, returning. That means keep the red buoys on your right and the green buoys on your left when entering the harbor. The buoys are numbered and they increase in number as the vessel moves into the bay. The nautical chart shows us where these buoys are located. The chart symbol for a buoy is a diamond with a small circle at its base. If a buoy is lighted, the symbol will have a glowing halo around the small circle. The lights are color green for the left side of a channel and red for the right side when entering a port. On this chart, the red buoys appear to be purple. As you can see, the first channel buoys are numbered 5 and 6 at the bottom of the chart. Buoys numbered 1 through 4 are on another chart that could be attached to the bottom of this one. As we proceed in the channel, the numbers increase. The next marker buoys are 7 and 8. The green buoys on the left will always have odd numbers. The red buoys on the right will always have even numbers. Again, if you remember the old mariner saying, red, right, returning, you should have no problem finding your way along a marked channel. Buoys are also used for other purposes around the bay. This symbol on the chart depicts safe areas for boating and looks like this on the bay. Large ships entering and leaving the harbor need to stay in the channel, the deepest part of the bay, so they don't run aground. On the chart, a solid line in the middle marks the deepest, safest place in the channel, while the edges of the channel are marked by dashed lines. Buoys are located along the edge of the channel to guide the mariner. If we start here at green buoy number 11, you'll see the note says G11FLG4S. That means that the light on G green buoy number 11, FL, flashes G green 4S every 4 seconds. Now let's look at the symbol for buoy number 12. What color is the light on this buoy? And how often does it light? The chart says R12, red buoy number 12. FL flashes R red 2.5S every 2.5 seconds. These detailed notes are at every buoy on the chart. In addition to the buoys, navigators use range markers to make sure they stay in the safe and central part of the channel. Range markers are lighted or unlighted stationary markers. When visually aligned vertically in pairs, they indicate the navigator is in the center of the channel. If we follow the solid line marking the center of the channel upward into the harbor, we see that it passes through a symbol that is a black dot with a magenta plume marked QG25FT. This means that this light is a Q, quick flashing, G, green light that is 25 feet above the surface of the water. This is the first and lowest range marker. If we continue along the dotted line, it stops at the second taller marker, a black dot with a magenta plume marked ISO G6S55FT. ISO means that this range marker has a flashing light of equal timing between flashes. The light is G, green, and flashes on for 6 seconds and off for 6 seconds. The range marker is mounted 55 feet above the water. This is the second and highest range marker. When a navigator lines up the two markers, the one mounted on a pole 25 feet above the water, below the one on Shelter Island that is 55 feet above the water, he or she will be in the center of the channel. To continue to navigate safely beyond buoys 14 and 15, the navigator will have to turn right and depend on the green and red lighted buoys marking the rest of the channel. Steve and I have covered some of the most important symbols on a nautical chart. We've talked about the scale of the chart, how to read a compass rose, and how important knowing the local magnetic variation is in steering a course. We've discussed how to read the depth of the water, how to find what the bottom is made of. And finally, we talked about aids to navigation and how they help navigators stay in the channel and not run their ships aground. I hope this will encourage you to visit the bay and point out to your friends all you know about chart reading and navigation. Thank you.